And Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness among the wild animals. Tell these stones to become bread. Jesus knew God's word, and so he answered, "No, the word of God says people don't live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." And so Jesus passed the first test. Then Satan took him to Jerusalem and said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off. For the word of God says he will order his angels to protect you, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone." Wait. But Jesus said, "The word of God also says you must not test the Lord your God." Now. And so Jesus passed the second test. So Satan took him to the peak of a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their glory. Satan said, "I will give it all to you if you kneel down and worship me." But Jesus said, "Get out of here, Satan, for the word of God says you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Satan went away, and angels came and took care of Jesus. And so Jesus passed the third and last test.
All right. I'm not sure that's an adequate portrayal, okay? I just want you to know that up front. They may have taken some liberties in putting that together. But it is good to see you all here. And we're actually a great day to be here because we're beginning a message. Actually, it's going to be sort of a mini-series within a series about overcoming temptation and temptation. But first of all, I just want you to know that I know you can be a lot of places, and I don't want to ever take it for granted that you're here. And I want you to know that I really, truly appreciate you being here with us at the Odyssey Church. It's something I don't do often. Maybe I should do it more often. But, you know, I'm going to thank the online audience that watches us as well, because they help us to fulfill the Great Commission of going out and making disciples and teaching those disciples to all the world to do what Jesus has told us to do. And the good part about that is he says, "I am with you always, even to the very end." See, Jesus never leaves us on our own. We may think that sometimes. We may feel like that sometimes. But he's always with us, and he always goes with us. So wherever we go, he's there with us. And if you are here, you may have never thought about this before. You know, it's pretty amazing. Because if you hear, or you're watching online, or you're giving to the Odyssey Church, and we have people all over the United States that give the Odyssey Church, and we're so thankful for them, we can continue with them. But you are a fulfillment of prophecy that took place over 2,000 years ago. You don't even realize that sometimes. Because Jesus said that we're to go and make disciples of all the nations, teach these new disciples to obey the commands that I have given you, and you're allowing us to do that. You are doing that yourself. So Jesus made these promises over 2,000 years ago, and the people in this room, and the people around the world, and the people who are in church, and those that call ourselves Christians, are fulfillment of that prophecy and those commands that were made over 2,000 years ago. And I just think that's amazing. Because truly, if you think about it, the message of Jesus should have died with him on the cross. But there was an event that changed the way we measure all our history. There's an event that's so important to Christianity that we can't deny it. And as many historians have tried to deny it, many people have tried to deny it, it's undeniable. We measure history AC, or AD and BD, before Christ, after Christ, Latin for Adam and Minai, and BC before Christ, because of the resurrection. Because something happened. A man who was dead, and people knew he was dead, was alive again, and people who saw him dead and buried were talking to him. And that resurrection of Jesus Christ gives us the hope of life here on this earth, and to live it more abundantly, because Jesus said it's not just about dying and going to heaven, it's about living this life and living more abundantly, and life after this life. There is life after this life. So by choosing to help us, you are the fulfillment of God's promises. Pretty sweet. Originally, I wanted to sort of take this message and We're in this longer series called Seeing Jesus Through the Eyes of the Doctor. And if you haven't been here, or if this is your first time here, and haven't been here in a long time, the doctor we're talking about is Luke. He writes a gospel, and gospel is simply the history of Jesus Christ and his life and his ministries. And there's four gospel writers, and Luke was one of them. We know Luke was a doctor. So we're looking at Jesus through the eyes of this doctor. And Luke does something that the other gospel writer doesn't do. He gives an introduction to what he's talking about. And in that introduction, he tells us that he has carefully investigated, that he has carefully researched, and he has carefully written about the things that he's put in this letter to a man called Theophilus. Theophilus means lover of God. If you're a lover of God, that means he's writing to you, that you can be certain of the truth which you are being taught, that you and I can be certain of the things that are in this world. Because Luke has carefully researched it, and Luke has carefully gone through the evidence, and he's only put in here what he could prove. So, like I said, last week I asked my wife, you know, and she kept telling me the things I repeat. But there's a reason I repeat it. It's because I love you, and God loves you. And he wants you to know that you can be certain, that you don't have to question the things in this world. And there have been many, many people that have sought out to actually destroy this, and they've gone out to prove it wrong. And really, when you start doing the research, those that have studied the hardest to make the Bible out to be a liar end up doing the exact opposite and become followers of Christ, because when they start looking at the evidence is undeniable that Jesus Christ is exactly who he says he is. And if you're here and you're not quite sure of that, again, that's exactly why we have this church. We want to love on you. We hope you keep coming back, because the fact is, whether you believe Jesus is God, whether you believe Jesus is the person he says he is or not, if you apply the things that are written in the scriptures, if you apply the teachings of Jesus and the teachings of God in the Old Testament and New Testament to your life will be better. You will have better relationships. You will have better finances. You will have a better family life. Your work life will go better. These principles work when you believe God is who he says he is or not. Amen. So I wanted to, as we go through Luke and I'm studying Luke, I come to this section of scripture, which I'm very familiar with, and I'm thinking to myself, you know, we'll just go through this, and I know the key points, and I just do the study to verify what I already know. And as I got studying, I began to look at some of the things that, and some of the places that I get a lot of inspiration from. One is my favorite Bible study teacher, a guy by the name of Ed Miller. Ed is just an incredible teacher. He can glean more out of one sentence than I can get out of a whole chapter in the Bible. And I got looking at his teachings, and he's given more than one teachings, but the one that I looked at, he had over 3 hours worth of just teachings on 13 verses. And I'm thinking to myself, there ain't no way I'm getting up and speaking for 3 hours. I mean, some people are going to think it feels that way, but it's not really going to be 3 hours. I'll just condense all this down in 1 hour, and we'll be okay. And then I started looking at one of my favorite pastors I get inspiration from. He actually spoke almost 4 hours on these same 13 verses. And I started looking at some other things, and before long, I realized that if I condense this down into just one simple message, that I was doing you a disservice, that I was not being fair to you or fair to myself, and that if we truly want to be transformed, if we truly want to live the way God wants us to live, there is so much meat, there is so much stuff in here that I would be doing you an injustice and doing myself an injustice if I didn't go through it. So we're actually going to take the next 3 weeks to go over this, because we do want to know for sure how we can enter into heaven's Lord. And there was a good message on that last week, not because I spoke it, but because the facts were so clear in it. And if you missed that, you can always go to our YouTube channel or odysseychurch.com or to our, we actually have an app now. You can download the app and watch there. I'm hoping that it's up sometime this week. But I think you all agree with me, maybe you will. One of the reasons we never really surrender our lives to God, the one that we don't live for, the one who died for us, is temptation. You know, we're just tempted to do the things that we like to do. We're just tempted to do the things and to please ourselves and to live by the way we want to live, you know, because, well, the fact of the matter is, sin is tempting, right? We don't do it because sin is still tempting, You know, I used to tell people, if you're not enjoying the sin you're in, yeah, you're doing it wrong. Because I was in sin for a lot of years, and I didn't turn my life over to God because I really liked the things that I wanted. I didn't even know why I was supposed to cut my hair the other day. Man, I couldn't stop. It's like, God, Lord, I know you're telling me not to do this. Lord, I know this is nothing. Doesn't make any sense. And that's really where I was when I was living for myself. So the first thing we have to do is, one of the reasons, and the scripture says, here's how you can know if you're going to enter in for sure, you're going to enter into the spiritual store. Prove by the way you live. Prove by the way you live that you have repented and that you have turned your life towards God. And the way that you know that your life is going in the right direction is that you will bear good fruit. So the first thing, I think we need to do in this politically correct environment of ours is we need to call it what it is. We cheat on our taxes a little bit, we just fudge a little bit. We have sex outside of marriages. We refuse to forgive people that have hurt us. We forge the expense report. We do something a little extra that maybe we shouldn't do because we know if we do, we'll close the deal. Maybe it's a promotion and you backstab the guy who's in line with you so that you get it. And then you start making excuses for what you do. You're saying, hey, that's just the way the world operates today. Everybody in my industry does that. If I didn't do that, I couldn't even feed my family. We start making these excuses, and we think ourselves, God's going to punish us. Well, the fact of the matter is, in the book of Romans, it says God never punishes anybody. We punish ourselves.
That's right.
We punish ourselves by not believing in Jesus Christ, who is the Son of God, and putting our faith and trust in Him. We make excuses. In other words, here's what we do. In other words, we justify what isn't just. No, we justify what isn't just. We get caught in the midst of adultery. We get caught stealing from our employers. Or we're doing everything by all means necessary, fair or unfair, to make that deal. And when we get caught, we say things like, I made a mistake. Honey, I cheated on you and I love you and I made a mistake. I'm really sorry. It's not a mistake. Okay, 2 + 2 = 4. And if I accidentally write down 5, that's a mistake. But if I know 2 + 2 = 4 and I write down 5 because there's something better in it for me, I put down 5, I get a bigger bonus. I put down 5, she's going to love me more. If I put down 5, I get to please myself right now. That is not a mistake. That's just falling for the reasons. It's sin. You didn't make a mistake. You sinned. And it's a politically correctness. We don't like that word anymore. We're justifying what's not just. And when we do, we begin to make excuses. And we tell ourselves, and we tell others, we made a mistake. And in reality, we're just turning away from God and turning towards ourselves and doing whatever it is that we're wanting to do. And we're not bearing good fruit. In fact, in a lot of cases, we're not only not bearing any good fruit, we're bearing bad fruit. And God tells us in His Word, if you're not bearing any fruit, even if you're not bearing bad fruit, you're just not bearing any fruit, that the bottom line is you'll be like the tree who bears no fruit. You'll be cut down and thrown into the fire. And that's why I believe this week and next week may be possibly one of the most important series God's ever given me to do. Because the fact of the matter is, all of us have been tempted, right? Not only do we all face temptations, all of us have given in to that temptation at one time or another. I'd love to tell you that I was up here and that I never was tempted and I never sinned, but I'm not going to sit up here and tell you. I told somebody the other day, it's real easy to sit up here and speak absolute truth, but as soon as I walk off the stage, I know how hard it is to live. It's real easy up here to tell everybody what to do, but it's so hard to live. And some of you today may be in the wilderness. Some of you today may be going through some very, very, very difficult things. And the temptations of those things are really affecting your life. The temptation to bargain with God. The temptation to get the promotion. The temptation to say, God, I say I trust you, but in this one area right now, I just can't do it. There's too much going on. It's too painful. It's too hurt. That's my family over there. And we all know that, but the fact is, most of us don't have the tools, we don't know the practical application, how to overcome that. And that's why I think it's so important that over the next 3 weeks we take time to not just learn why, because we all know we shouldn't do it, But how do we overcome these things? And like I said, I know how hard it is because we don't always think about these things. It's like me in the mirror. You know, I'm tempted to cut my hair and I'm thinking, well, don't do it. Today is Saturday, tomorrow is Sunday. If you mess this up really bad, you've got no time to fix it. And yet, here I am. Fell into the temptation, gave into it, and did it anyway. And I'm not saying that's sinful behavior, but it certainly wasn't the wisest decision I could make on Saturday at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, part of the problem is most of us probably are aware of the story of Jesus going out in the wilderness. And one of the problems we have when we come to a familiar passage of Scripture is we already know the story. And we've already read the story, and some of us have even read the background of the story, and some of us have heard sermons on the stories. And because it's familiar, we come to it with the idea of, I already know what's going to be said, I already know about it, so we sort of tune it out. We don't come back. And the reason I know that is exactly how I came to this section of Scripture. I had planned to speak on it for just one lesson, because I already knew about it. I knew what the key points were. I heard messages on it. I knew what I wanted to say. I was just going to start studying to verify what I already know. But I'm going to tell you right now, I was absolutely wrong. You know, the amazing part, God's Word is so amazing to me. Because sometimes it's just deep enough to wet your feet. It's so simple, a child can understand it. But at the same time, the same verses are so deep that theologians have argued over them for years. We serve this infinite God, and His Word is an infinite Word. And sometimes, a lot of times, God will reveal new truths or old truths in a new way. And that's exactly what He did to me. There's just 13 verses. I've heard many a message like that. He revealed it to me in a new way. So there's some things that we know deep down in our hearts, and maybe they've never surfaced, maybe you've never thought about it. And I know in my case, this is true. Because as I began to do the research for this, as I began to study this, as I began to ask God to open my eyes and my heart, He began to reveal to me what I knew, but it never boiled down to the surface. One of the reasons that I was continually falling into the temptations, and most of us don't fall into different temptations. We sort of have the same temptations, you know. So for some of us, maybe it's alcohol or drug abuse. For some of us, maybe it's finances. For some of us, maybe it's relationships or whatever it is, food, for example. You know, all of us have these certain temptations that are come to us. God, we're created beings, and created beings work in patterns. And that's why we can so effectively destroy Satan if we try, because we have this power of God in us who is infinite, and Satan is a created being. And Satan has patterns because he is created, and we can start to pick up on the patterns that he uses to attack us. And that's the first thing, is just being aware. But there's three things in particular I want to discuss starting today, and these things are things that all of us know, but maybe we've never thought of. Maybe you have. You know, I got to be honest with you, I hadn't. Anytime we're tempted to do what in our inner being we know we shouldn't do, anytime we're trying to justify what we know it just, anytime we just, that's all what it is, anytime we say yes to sin, even small things, three things are going to happen. First of all, we're going to steal from our future. We're going to steal from our future. It's going to take me a while to grow this back. Second of all, we are replacing the important with the immediate. I can't help it. I know it's important. But I don't want to wait till next week, so I'm going to take care of it immediately right now. And the second thing is, or the third thing is, the final thing is, and this is most important, at least in an internal sense, we're just telling God, we don't trust you, God. We don't trust you enough to give me something better in the future, so I'm just going to take care of what I got to take care of right now so I can have it, because I don't trust you enough to give me more or even give me this much in the future. God, I don't trust you enough to delay my gratification now so you can give me something even better in the future. And this is important. I think this is so important because we all fall into temptation at times, and most of us do it without even thinking or thinking about the repercussions, because we don't look at it in a future sense. We only look at it in the present sense. I want to do this, and I want to do it now, so I'm going to do it. So I'm going to give you a real-life example. And I'm going to start out by telling you that in this example, there is no condemnation in anyone, okay? But my dad was a very heavy smoker. My dad was a 5-pack-a-day smoker. That's 100 cigarettes a day. And he would justify it. He knew in his heart it wasn't right, but he justified it wasn't just. He said, well, Robbie, I light up five packs of cigarettes a day, but I don't smoke that many. And he said, you know, son, when I was growing up, smoking, they didn't know how bad it was for you. In fact, I didn't know this. My dad pointed out, I went back and checked. In the old movies like Humphrey Bogart and in Dean Martin, the cigarettes that you were actually bigger cigarettes than a real cigarette. They were actually a little bit larger because it was so cool to smoke. You know, they look cool smoking. Dean Martin smoked on stage almost every concert. That was part of his routine. Humphrey Bogart always had a cigarette hanging out of his mouth. He says, just the time he grew up. And son, you know, I want to be cool like everybody else. Everybody wanted to be like a Hollywood star, so we all started smoking. We didn't know it was bad for us. And he was right. But he knew that it was still wrong, and he knew now of the ramifications. And I'm not judging anybody here in smoking. You need to know this. I started smoking when I was 8 years old. I quit smoking when I was 32, I think it was. I know what smoking's about. I know the struggle is real, so I'm not condemning anybody in here. If you're a smoker, I'm not talking about you. I love you. It's just one thing. But it don't matter whether you're a smoker or not, smoker. We all know smoking is bad for you. We can justify it any kind of way. I can't quit. You know, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. But we all know that it's bad for your health. You know, I love my dad. And I hope that one day when I get to eternity, he's there. That's the one thing that God's never given clarity on. He walked in the bank one time, and, you know, it was before they had changed the laws, and said, thank you for not smoking. You don't have to thank me. Continue to smoke. When they did change the laws in public places, you couldn't smoke. My dad had a public office. He put a sign there, non-smokers are welcome in this office. He just continued to smoke. And he was right in what he said. They didn't know the ramifications of smoking at the time. And, he didn't smoke 100 cigarettes a day. I've been in his office before where he had a lit cigarette in the ashtray. He had one on his hand. He would grab one out of the pack and light it with the one in his hand. He's got three cigarettes burning at the same time. It was just a subconscious habit and a physical habit that he just couldn't break. He tried many times. So I don't blame him. I was there. I know. But it was no surprise to me, my family, or anybody else, or even to my dad, when right after his 62nd birthday, he got diagnosed with inoperable lung cancer. It wasn't a surprise. He smoked 5 packs of cigarettes a day. What was my dad really want? You know, and again, this is not condemnation. Please don't. I was a smoker. I fall into temptation. I sin, but I just want to use it as an illustration. My dad was stealing from his future. See, my dad died a month and a half after his diagnosis. He died 3 months after his 62nd birthday. If you think about the fact that the average lifespan is 80 years old, my dad stole 18 years of his future life by replacing the important, which was a long life, with the immediate, which was the gratification of the cigarette. And he was sort of telling God, I don't trust you enough to give me rest and relaxation and peace, so I'm going to smoke this cigarette now so I can do it myself. Now, that's not his mental process, okay? I want you to know that. The reason this message is so important is I want you to know when you're tempted, this is the process we go to on a subconscious level. And without awareness, you can't fix it. So you have to become aware of what the problem is before you can fix the problem. But here's the other thing we all know. Not only was he stealing from his future, he was stealing from the future of the people that loved him the most and that he loved the most. I mean, he took 18 years of marriage from my mom. He took 18 years of life experiences and things that he could have taught me from me. He took 18 years of times he could have spent with his family. He took 18, he reached out into the future, replaced the important with the immediate, and took 18 years away from all of us that loved him. And took 18 years away from himself. And again, I'm not condemning my dad. I'm not even blaming my dad. Because we don't go through this mental process when we're doing things like that. But that's really what is important. I said, I don't blame him because we all fall into temptation. We all fall into it one way or another, or at one time or another, but that's why I believe these next couple weeks are just so important. Because we're all tempted at times. And even though we know it's wrong, nobody's ever really taken the time to show us how not to do it, not to fall into temptations. And over the next 3 weeks, I hope to show you through the power of God, because those that know me, it's not in my power at all, is how every single temptation that the Satan can throw at you and God will allow to come your way can be overcome. Every single one of them. But the real life application for overcoming is as simple to say as it is to live. And I know that because we like to justify what is not just. And when we do this, we're just simply telling God, I don't trust you enough to take my needs and my desires and my future to you. I'm just going to take care of myself right now. God, I don't trust you enough for this. I'm going to take care of the immediate. I'll worry about the important later. And I'll steal from my future. And we know this. I mean, that's why credit card debt is so rampant. You know, we want it now, and we don't have to wait. So we'll give up the important, our future finances for the immediate, and then we'll pay 30% interest on it, right? And there's a way that God can teach us through the scriptures. So when I first started, I was going to make point, and go move on. But really, truly, I think that the practical application is the most important part. And through this, God is going to give us three examples of every way we can ever be tempted and how we can overcome them. So I'm really looking forward to this. I'm looking to do more study, and I'm really asking God to put it into our hearts, into our minds, and particularly with me, so I can pass it on to you. But I know this is true because that's how I lived for most of my life. You know, the only person I cared about was me. You know, I'm not saying I didn't love other people, and I didn't say I didn't care about other people. But when it really came down to it, when I look back on it, I was a very selfish person. I would steal time out of my future by going into debt, by being promiscuous, by drinking, by doing all kinds of stuff that I shouldn't be doing. And when you do that, you can't take it back. Your mind's a tape recorder. It remembers those things. You can't forget it. So I hurt people, and I never intentionally hurt anybody, but I did, and I hurt myself. I stole from my future, I stole from their future, I replaced what was important with the immediate, and the fact of the matter is, I believe in God, but I wasn't living for God, so the fact that I didn't trust God didn't even enter in my mind. The fact that I was replacing the important with the immediate, you know, I'm thinking to myself, well, Pat, I'm pretty important. And I immediately need this right now. And what I was really doing, I was stealing from my future self and I was stealing from my future family's life. Because there are things that you can't forget and they can't forget. And, you know, I brought all those things into the relationship with my wife and then I passed them on to my kids. And it's all these things because I was tempted and I didn't realize what was going on. I just sort of did it. So we're going to spend the next couple weeks going through Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. So that we can gain some insight on how to resist and avoid the temptation to fall into sin. And we can make excuses. And we can say, I made a mistake. And we can justify what's not just. We can sort of just do what we want to do. But over the next couple weeks, we're just going to call what it is. We're going to call it sin. And I said, this is church. I probably ought to read some scriptures. So you feel like you're in the church this morning. So get the Bible this morning. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn into Luke chapter 4. And if you like the translation I'm reading from, or you don't have a Bible, you know, there's a couple up here I've warned about. Please take one, grab one as you leave. Take them, bring them back next week, write notes in them. Be a good steward of what God talks to you about and says to your heart. Just don't think that you're going to remember, because that usually doesn't happen. Write it down. Be a good steward of what God says to your heart. And if you're not a Christian, or maybe you've never read a lot of the Bible, or maybe you find the Bible difficult to understand, I'll sort of challenge you and ask you to, over the next couple weeks, to just read over and over just Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. Because is this a something that we're all on common ground with? You know, there's some things in the scripture, and you read it and say, well, that doesn't apply to me. You know, I've never had that problem before. But temptation is a something that we all can agree that we have a common ground on. So this is a great place to start if you've never read the Bible, or you're just starting out, or you're not sure if Jesus is who he says he is. This would be a great place. It's just 13 verses. It doesn't take long to read. And hopefully, we'll all gain some insight on how to overcome temptation. Now, sort of give you a little bit of the background of where we're at in Jesus' life. John the Baptist has come on the scene, but we haven't heard anything from Jesus since he was 12 years old. No mention of his growing up. There's been no mention of really anything. There's no words that he spoke. And then one day, a man named John the Baptist shows up on the scene. And John the Baptist begins to do something nobody had ever done before. Now, people had baptized before, but they never baptized for repentance. You were baptized if you were a Gentile, a non-Jew, if you decided you wanted to be a Jew, to wash off the filth and the scum of being a Gentile and make yourself pure so you could be a Jew. But John is baptizing for repentance. And he's making announcements that he's quoting from the Old Testament. And John the Baptizer is actually fulfilling something that God had wrote about 760 years before. He comes out of this desert and he's saying, he is a voice shouting in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord's coming. Now, all the Jews knew what he was talking about. This was written by Isaiah 760 years ago. Clear the road for him, the valleys will be filled and the mountains held made level, the curves will be straight and the rough places made smooth, and all the people will see the salvation of the Lord. So John's preparing the way for Jesus, and one day as he's baptizing people on the Jordan River, Jesus just sort of steps into the picture. And Jesus comes down to the Jordan and says, John, you have to baptize me. And at first John's like, no way, I can't do that, Jesus. You need to baptize me. But Jesus says, John, in order to fulfill everything that God's written, you have to baptize me. So John, in that moment, he realizes the importance of it. And he baptizes Jesus. Even though John knew, Jesus knew, there was no sin in him, he didn't have to be baptized or repent. And this is so great. This is so amazing to me. Jesus didn't have to be baptized for repentance, but he was baptized. Number one, as an example of what we should do. But number two, so he could identify with the sin. Because God, in his wisdom, wrote in the book hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years ago that one day Jesus would be nailed to a cross and your sins and my sins and the sins of the entire world will be placed upon his shoulders. He says, John, you have to fulfill this prophecy. But John does. And when he does, amazing things happen. This is so great. I love this. The last two verses of Luke chapter 3, right before it goes into the genealogy. So there, these last verses 21 and 22. And really, there's a genealogy. And then we go into chapter 4, verse 1. It says, Jesus himself was baptized as he was praying. The heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit in bodily form descended upon him like a dove. And a voice from heaven said, you are my dearly son, and you I am well pleased, and you bring me great joy. Jesus gets baptized, and God's in heaven. He said, yay, that is my son down there. Angels and seraphim and people on the Jordan bank, do you see him? He's my son. I am well pleased. He brings me so much joy. Yay. And then all of a sudden, the Spirit of God comes down, and Jesus is filled with the Spirit. Heaven's open up. But next, chapter 4, verse 1 says, then. What does then mean? Then means immediately after, right after. Then, right after, then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, full of God, returned to the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. You read that and you're like, whoa, wait just a minute. This is Jesus the Christ. This is Jesus. This is the first day on his big job. The first day to bring salvation into the world. And we have just heard God say, I love you, I am well pleased with you, and you bring me great joy. And where does he go? To the desert. And who leads him right after that, full of the Spirit? God the Father. His own Father just told everybody how much he loved him. And does he give him a nice, comfortable raise and tell him to go on his way? No, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, is led into the desert where he will be tempted for 40 days. See, we think there's only three temptations sometimes, but he was tempted day in, day out for 40 straight days. See, this is one of the reasons I know the Bible is so real. Because if man wrote the Bible, we'd leave this stuff out. It doesn't even make sense. You know, we leave that kind of stuff out. This goes against everything we believe. A loving Father, just doesn't send his son into the wilderness to be tempted by the master tempting himself. The devil, Satan, the adversary, does he?
A wise one does.
But this is so important. Or it should be so important. Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. See, here's the thing. A lot of times, when we're in those wilderness experiences, a lot of times when we're in the desert, temptation comes our way. When Satan's around every corner we turn, you like to think something like, you know, did I do something wrong? You know? God, are you mad at me? I mean, don't you love me anymore? You are dearly loved, my son, and you bring me great joy. Dad, thank you so much. So where are we going from here? I know you love me. I know you're well pleased. I know I bring you great joy. Do we go get some ice cream now? Now, son, I'm going to take you into the wilderness and take you out in the desert. God, I'm full of the Holy Spirit. I know, son, but you're going to be tempted by the devil himself. Hey, that doesn't seem right. You just told me and everybody else that you love me. I do. Well, did I do something wrong? Nope. I'm well pleased with you. You bring me great joy. So where are we going? Well, I'm staying here, but you're going out in the desert. You're going to be tempted. You and the devil. You and the master tempter, the king of tempters. You guys are going to spend some alone time together. Sounds so weird. If you were to make the Bible up, you wouldn't put this kind of stuff in here. And I think this is so important because as I read the scripture, I see God did the same thing to Adam and Eve, our you know, really the parents of all of us. He allowed them to be tempted, and we all know they failed miserably. We still suffer for it today. But they didn't stay that way. They repented, they turned their life back to God, and that gave God the opportunity to bring a Savior in the world so me and you could spend eternity with Him.
Amen.
God did the same thing to Abraham, the father of the Jewish nation. He sent Moses to be tempted in the desert for 40 years. He sent King David. Didn't David, we know, he's a man after God's own heart. But wait a minute, he thought that temptation was a daughter of the murderer. Yeah, but I love him. I'm well pleased. I sent him into the desert. He failed the test, but he repented. And people are still looking to him today. Read Psalm 51. Psalm of repentance, David's repentance. He did the same thing to John the Baptizer. He did the same thing to Mary and Joseph. He did the same thing to all the apostles. He did the same thing to Paul. And now he even does it to his own son. So if you're in the desert today, if you're in the wilderness today, there may be a reason for it. Because this brings us to the good news. Now there's a lot of reasons that I can think of, but there are three that stand out. It's very important to me. First, if you're a Christian, and I've done this, you think to yourself, well, if I was really a true Christian, if I was really full of the Holy Spirit, I wouldn't have those thoughts. I wouldn't look at her that way. I wouldn't watch that show on TV. I wouldn't be tempted to even do those things if I was really full of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, was led into the into the desert, into the wilderness. I don't care how mature you are. I don't care how long you've been a Christian. I don't care how full you are of the Holy Spirit. There's going to be times when you're tempted. Temptation is not the sin.
Right.
The sin is when you give in to the temptation.
Yeah,
true. Now, you know, second thing is, if you're not a Christian, and one of the reasons you're not a Christian is because you see how Christians act. And we've all been there. I've heard almost everybody here say it one time or another, and I've felt it myself. And anybody in this series, you'll know that Christianity isn't about perfection. Being a Christian isn't about perfection, it's about progression. And even those full of the Spirit will be tempted. And even those full of the Spirit will be making mistakes. But it's about progression. Do you look like you did 10 years ago? If you do, you ought to be praying a little bit harder about your Christianity. Because you should be better today than you were yesterday. Do you look on Monday morning at work like you do on Sunday in church? And if you don't, then you may want to question your Christianity and your salvation. Maybe by the end of the series, if what's been keeping you from being a Christian is Christians, you'll realize just because they're full of the Holy Spirit, just because they know the Scripture, doesn't mean they're perfect.
Right.
It's not about perfection. It's about progression. Now, that doesn't mean there's no need for repentance. Scriptures are clear on it. Prove by the way you live that you turn to God and have repented and bear good fruit. But if God allowed Jesus to be tempted, if God allowed His one and only Son to be tempted, we have to know at times we're going to be tempted. In fact, we have to know at times God may be the one that has led us into the wilderness, into the desert experience, to be tempted. Even if we're doing everything right, even if we're full of the Holy Spirit, but God, this loving God, just doesn't tell us that He's going to do this. He tells us the why, and then He tells us how to overcome the temptations of the light, the temptations we face in the wilderness and the desert experience. Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness where He was tempted for 40 days. And maybe the greatest reason of all is this, is that we can find great comfort. We can find great comfort and great love in these verses because we all, every single one of us has spent some time, some of us a lot of time, in the wilderness, haven't we? We've all been tempted, we've all fallen into temptation, and we've all sinned, and God gives us a way to break the frustration of temptation. But maybe, just maybe today, you're the one in the wilderness. Maybe you're in the wilderness right now, right at this minute, and you think you're there because it's something you've done. You think God is punishing you. But maybe, just maybe, you didn't get there on your own. You're in the wilderness, and it's hard and temptation on every side. Because every corner you turn, there's Satan attacking you. And I remember a preacher one time said, Jesus doesn't attack you every day. Maybe it's because you're going in the same direction. You're not in the desert because God is mad at you. You're not in the desert because God doesn't love you. You're not experiencing temptation because God isn't pleased with you. You're in the desert. You're in the wilderness because of the exact opposite. God loves you. And He's well pleased with you. And you bring Him great joy. In fact, you're where you're at because He loves you so much. He loves you as much. If you're in the wilderness, that means He loves you as much as He loves Jesus, His only one and only Son. If you're in the wilderness, it means He loves you so much that He loves you as if you were His very own Son. It means He has great plans for your life. And He sends you out in the wilderness. Maybe you're in the wilderness of a health problem. Maybe you just got a bad diagnosis from the doctor. Maybe you're in the wilderness because a family member is in trouble. Maybe you have a prodigal son or a prodigal daughter, or you have a family member with a health problem, and you are now in the middle of the desert, the wilderness. Or maybe you're facing a financial problem, and it just seems like everywhere you turn, Satan is throwing darts at you, and you can't miss it, and you're starting to be tempted to take a shortcut. You're like, God, I'm going to reach out in my future, and I'm going to get some of this pressure off of me. I'm going to forget about what's important. I'm going to take care of it immediately because I just can't trust you enough to take care of it for me. So I'm going to take care of it myself. Maybe you're in the desert. You're in the wilderness because God has great plans for your life. See, as I read these scriptures, the people that God used, the mightiest, the leaders, the teachers, the ones that even today, thousands of years later, are still bearing good fruit. Every one of them had to go through a testing. Every one of them spent time in the wilderness. Every one of them had a time, even though they were full of the Holy Spirit, where they went out into the desert and they had to spend some alone time with Satan. Some of them failed the test. But all of them repented, turned back to God, and proved by the way they lived They bore good fruit, and some of them are still bearing fruit today, even thousands of years later. But before they could, before they did, they had to go through a wilderness experience. They had to go through the desert and prove by the way that they lived, that they had repented of their sin and turned to God. And when they did, their lives bore great fruit for God. And maybe, just maybe, that's the plan that God has for your life today. And you're in the wilderness, not because he's mad at you, not because he doesn't love you, but the fact that he loves you so much that he wants to draw you closer to him, that he wants you to gain strength for him. He wants to give you the power to overcome every temptation. He wants to give you the power to overcome Satan himself. Because Jesus, his brother James, writes in his writings, resist the devil and he must be believed. But you got to pay attention. Got to pay attention to verse 13, the last verse. It says, when the devil had finished tempting Jesus, he left him until the next opportunity came. See, the pendulum always swings the other way. If you're in the middle, if you're in the middle of the wilderness, if you're in the middle of the desert right now, know there is a time to come. Know there is a time of coming when when Satan will flee and Jesus will come in. And victory is right around the corner. You're almost there. Just hold on a little bit longer. But if you're in the midst of great things right now, your life's going so good that you can't even hardly stand it, I want you to rejoice in it. I want you to embrace it. I want you to just enjoy it right now. Because he's coming back. And he'll tempt you again. And I want you to be prepared so that you can overcome the temptation, every temptation Satan can throw your way when he does. And it doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't even matter what you're doing right now. Because I love you and God loves you so much that we want you to know how you can get out of what you're in, or if you're tempted to go into something that you can't, that you can get out of it. Because I love you. The Odyssey Church loves you. God loves you. And he gives us this way to overcome our wilderness experience and the temptations they bring, because we all know that when we get into temptation, sin will steal from our future. When we sin, we're replacing the important with the immediate. And we sin, we're simply telling God, I don't trust you. I don't trust you, God, to give me more in the future, so I'm going to get for myself what I can get right now. And here's the thing, even though we know it's true, and we all know, we all face temptation, we've all sinned, but the good news is, we have a Savior who knows what it's like to be tempted. Because full of the Holy Spirit, God led him into the wilderness to be tempted. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, the author tells us that Jesus understands our weaknesses, for he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. And you say, well, wait a minute. Jesus never had to go through divorce. He never faced those temptations. Jesus never had a health problem. He never faced that temptation. Jesus didn't have children. There's no way he even had a prodigal son. But really, there's only three ways that we can be tempted. We're going to look at those over the next 3 weeks. There's only three ways we can be tempted, and every temptation falls into one of these three categories. Jesus gives us this formula so we don't have to sin. Because it's precious for us. Although he faced the same testings we did, he did not sin. So sort of set up the next 3 weeks, I'm going to ask you to stand with me, and as I close, I want you to repeat this with me. And I know some of you go, well, I don't repeat stuff. I don't care. You know, I'll pretend I'm moving them out. I want you to put that aside, if you would, right now, and just repeat these words after me. I'm going to say them first, and then we'll say them together. I want you to be comfortable with them, and then I'll have you repeat them after me. And this is to set us up that's going to go over the next couple of weeks. So will you stand with me? And then I'll say them first, and you can repeat them after me. I feel the frustration of temptation. But it will not steal my future. It will not steal my faith. It will not steal my joy. Because I will not give in to sin. I feel the frustration of temptation. But I will not let it steal my future. I will not let it steal my faith. I will not let it steal my joy, because I will not give in to sin. pray for you, and I want to encourage you to come back next week as we ask the question, what are you hungry for? I ain't talking about the diner down the road, okay? What are you hungry for? Because we're all hungry for something. Heavenly Father, we just thank you and we praise you, Lord, for what you're doing in our life and doing in our midst. And Father, we thank you that you just don't tell us what not to do and you don't just tell us what to do, that you actually tell us how to do it, how to avoid it. Father, I just pray over the next couple of weeks that you can give me wisdom and that you'll help me articulate what you want me to articulate. So each one of us leave here, not in our own power, but in your power, Lord. And Father, if there be one in here today that don't know you, that just knows about you and they're not quite sure, Lord, that you will begin to draw them ever closer to you. Father, we just thank you as we go about our day today that maybe, just maybe, your light can shine through our cracks. And that when we're faced by the tempter and in temptation, Lord, that we'll remember that we're not going to allow it to steal our future. We're not going to allow it to steal our joy. And we're not going to allow it to take our faith away from us, Lord. That we will not give in to sin. And we ask this in the precious name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. You are dismissed.